poems, I'd like to share with you two of my sources of imagination. The first, when I was a teenager in Indianapolis around 1951, and the second during my apprenticeship to poetry in Kyoto, Japan in 1963. This is called Tea for Two by Bud Powell. I started glancing at Downbeat magazine around 1951 when I was 16. I taped two quarters to an order form and mailed it off for a 45 RPM recording with Lenny Cristano's I Surrender, Dear on the other side. Piano as an orchestra of sound, waterfalling through Tea for Two changes with the skeleton of the melody bearing its trivia from moment to moment. I listened to it again and again, trying to grasp the difference between the song line and what Powell was doing to it. Melody versus improvisation, what someone else had written versus what Powell was doing to and with it. Somehow an idea vaguely made its way through. You don't have to play somebody else's melody. You can improvise. How? Make up your own tune. Wow, really? You mean I don't have to be my parents? I don't have to play their melody for the rest of my life? The alternative, being myself, was a stupendous enigma that took me another 6 years to even begin to approach. I had to get completely bored with all the possibilities my given life had prepared me for, including playing the piano, before I could make a grab at something that challenged me to change my life. Later, I realized that Paul had taken the trivial in music, as Art Tatum did with I'll See You in My Dreams, and transformed it into an imaginative structure. William Carlos Williams, I noted, had done something similar in poetry. While reading the Sunday comics on the living room floor was probably my first encounter as a boy with imagination. Paul was my first encounter as an adolescent with the figure of the artist. In The Gull Wall, 1975, I wrote a poem which brooded about Paul's tragic life and about what he'd offered me, which in the writing of the poem seemed to cut all the way back the neighborhood piano teacher lessons my mother started me on at six. Bud Powell locked in his Paris bathroom so he wouldn't wander, sipping his lunch from the cat saucer on the floor. I see him curled there, nursing his litter, his great swollen dugs, his sleepy Buddha face, looks down through the lotus pond, sees the damned astral miles below. Amongst them, a little unmoving Clayton Jr., placed by his mother on a bed of keys. Paul compassionately extended his tongue, licked my laid out senses. There was a gorgeous red, yellow, and green araneia centered in her web attached to a persimmon tree in the Ogamura backyard. I got used to taking a chair and a little table out there under the web where I grieved. After several weeks of spider sitting, the weather turned chill with rain and gusty wind. One afternoon I found the web wrecked, the spider gone. Something went through me that I can only describe as the sensation of the loss of one loved. I cried and for several days felt nauseous and absurd. A week later, I decided to motorcycle out to Northwest Kyoto and visit Gary Snyder. Gary was not home, so I had tea with Joanne Kiger, and late in the afternoon started the half-hour drive back home. Riding south on Junikan Dori, it appeared that the motorcycle handlebars had become ox horns, and that I was riding on an ox. A lumber company turned into a manger with baby Jesus and kneeling wise men. I forced myself to stay aware that I was in moving traffic and looking for a place to turn off, spotted Nijo Castle with its big tourist bus parking lot. Getting off my ox cycle, I felt commanded to circumambulate the square castle and its moat. I saw what seemed to be Kiger's eyeballs in the moat bar. At the northwest corner, I felt commanded to look up. Some 40 feet above my head was the spider, completely red, the size of a human adult, flexing her legs as if attached to and testing her web. After maybe 30 seconds, the image began to fade. I immediately felt that I'd been given a totemic gift and that it would direct my relationship to poetry. Out of my own body, I was to create a matrix strong enough in which to live and hunt. The alchemist Fulcanelli, quote, "The picture of the labyrinth is thus offered to us as emblematic of the whole labor of the work, with its two major difficulties. One, the path which must be taken in order to reach the center, where the bitter combat of the two natures takes place. The other, the way which the artist must follow in order to emerge. It is here that the thread of Ariadne becomes necessary for him, if he is not to wander among the winding paths of the task, unable to extricate himself." Anton Ehrenzweig, quote, "Any creative search, whether for a new image or idea, involves the scrutiny of an often astronomical number of possibilities. The correct choice between them cannot be made by a conscious weighing up of each single possibility cropping up during the search. If attempted, it would only lead us astray. A creative search resembles a maze with many nodal points. From each of these points, many possible pathways radiate in all directions, leading to further crossroads where a new network of high and byways comes into view. Each choice would be easy if we could command an aerial view of the entire network of nodal points and radiating pathways still lying ahead. This is never the case. If we could map out the entire way ahead, no further search would be needed. As it is, the creative thinker has to make a decision about his route without having the full information needed for his choice. This dilemma belongs to the essence of creativity. There is an archetypal poem, and its most ancient design is probably the labyrinth. One suddenly cuts in, leaving the green world for the apparent stasis and darkness of the cave. The first words of a poem propose and nose forward toward a confrontation with what the writer is only partially aware of, or may not be prepared to address until it emerges, flushed forth by digressions and meanders. Poetry twists toward the unknown and seeks to realize something beyond the poet's initial awareness. What it seeks to know might be described as the unlimited interiority of its initial impulse. If a last line or conclusion occurs to me upon starting to write, I have learned to put it in immediately so it does not hang before me, a lure, forcing the writing to skew itself in order to that this last line, in quotes, continues to make sense as such. As far as poetry is concerned, the bitter combat of the two natures can be understood as the poet's desire to discover something new or unique versus the spectral desire of tradition to defeat the new and to continue to assert its own primacy. It is a bitter combat because the realization which writing a poem may provide is inevitably partial. The minotaur is at best crippled, never slain. And the poet never strides forth from the labyrinth heroic and intact. At best, he crawls forth wounded, as in the cry of Cesar Vallejo in his poem, Intensity and Height. More than not, he never emerges at all. The poet never leaves this place of combat with a total poem, because such a poem would confirm that the discrepancy between desire and the fulfillment of desire has been eliminated. But since my desire is ultimately to create reality and not merely to observe it, I am bound to be defeated if reality is at stake in my poem's ambition. As I emerge from the poem, regardless of what I've realized while in the poem, I am back in the observable biological continuum and part of it, part of its absolute mortality. Over the decades, I've composed close to 100 poems on art and artists. I'm interested in what I see in paintings as well as what the paintings see in me. Here are 8 poems, 5 on paintings, 1 on a photographer, 1 on a sculptor, and 1 on a toy. I would like to dedicate my reading this evening to the Ypsilanti-based painter, Nancy Flanagan. When Carol and I visited our painter friends Leon Golub and Nancy Sparrow in New York City in 1974, Leon told us that a few months earlier he had entered his apartment building at 71st and Broadway to be accosted by an armed man in the elevator who demanded that he let him into his apartment. Leon's youngest son, Paul, was in the apartment alone. Leon did what he was told. The man tied the two of them up, ransacked the apartment, and left. At that time, Golub was working on paintings depicting combat in the Vietnamese War. Leon Golub working on a painting. A man, white, about 28, in a blue denim suit, appeared below his ladder. "Can you tell me who lies in this work?" he asked. Leon replied, "To my left are American GIs and South Vietnamese troops. They fire into villagers fleeing their bomb cuts on the right." The man said, "Open up your place in the work. Let me take what I want or I'll kill you." He stood behind Golub on the ladder with a knife. "My youngest son is alone in my place in the work," Leon thought. Then he saw the man's eyes and knew he would kill. So he must open his place and take a chance the man would only steal, would not kill him and his youngest son. He slit the canvas. Together they entered an unprimed area where the boy was sleeping. "Honey, you have to get up. This man won't hurt us if we do what he says." The man bound and blindfolded both of them, made them lie down near the firing GIs. Leon could hear shouts maneuvering in the jungle. "Are you all right?" he would ask the boy. What the man was doing blended in with the GIs. The clamor went on and on. Finally, both Leon and his son fell asleep. They awoke, still bound, unable to see, but they could get up. Not hearing anyone, they got to their feet. It was wet, soggy, bent over heads almost between their knees. They began to duck walk, struggled on for hours, heard no one, seemed to be in a marsh. "I can't go on, can't we rest?" the boy said. "But we won't find anyone to help us out here." "Out where?" the boy asked. They had crossed over to the road. They heard voices, Vietnamese. Someone tugging at their rope pulled off the blindfolds. A gang of tall, burned men, bodies skinned, the blood charred, caked. "Cream?" one asked. Leon and the boy were beckoned into a hut. A at the table sitting in mock importance the man who forced Leon into his place. He was grinning, but not friendly. They were pushed by the burned men further in. "I want you to look at this map," the man said. He had spread it out, a piece of dirty cheesecloth with marks, smudges, lines drawn through lines. "We are here," pressed his finger on an obscure point. "And they are there," moved his finger a half an inch away. "Who are you?" Leon asked. "I am the general," the man shouted, "who commands both sides." He struck the table in two. Leon turned, reached for his son, but neither he nor the burned men were there. He turned back to the general, reaching at him, crying, "Where's my son?" "Where you said he was," the general held him off and kind of laughed. "Alone in your place in the work. Come outside and I'll show you where he leads." What else could Gollum do? The table and map were trash on the hut floor, the general already outside. Leon peered after him. It was night again. The burned men had built a fire. The boy they had somehow gotten into a large glass ball, which they had placed at the apex of the flames. Inside he seemed all right. There was room for a little desk. As the flames licked the ball, he seemed intent only on his homework, or whatever it was he scribbled away at. Then he saw 20 yards away, his father in great concern, in anguish, staring at him. "I'm okay," he signaled, "because you have cared for me in your place in the work. I am now placed outside, yet because of you, inside this new outside. The burned men are to shed their crusts. The unprimed place that I have left can accommodate the devil." Anne Michalowski, 1940-1999, was a central figure in Detroit's Cass Corridor art movement. Her paintings and watercolors range from expansive open vistas of water and sky to tiny realistic portraits of artists and friends. Along with her husband Ken, she was editor, publisher, and printer of the Alternative Press, Broadsides, and Postcards. For over 30 years. Here from my elegy for Anne, Blue Zone, is section 7, which riffs on her multidimensional working of the blue shadings in the water off Maine's Monhegan Island. Off Monhegan Island, the basic blue turned into courageous slate, shifting diaphanes of melancholy aqua green. The azure has a metallic edge, a dun infected will. In high ocean shadow, Clarity's tiara became a nebulous mass, a coma, a rain-soaked hyacinth. The ocean's ground was chipped with locking tints, inks and shields, crumbled steels, married to a verdigris, spotted and stained with forest, rising from a liquid core. An undulant ground, blue gum streaked ruby, russet and obscure, and then a modest larkspur pattern appeared, a humorous blue, as if Krishna's cyanotic body were the ocean's skin. Through rolling bronze, a red archangel spread out in serpentine flails, unending transformation in a single frame. Blues for Anne, peacock meridians in repose, blue air over crocodile and cream, oyster whites flecked with jelly yellows, a magnanimous blue chilled by receding shades, a tone at once a color and a mood, peaks and troughs leveled into a glaze, a frail synthesis shuttered by near-far thunder, by gusts of ruddy honeycomb winds, a horizon crawling with serpent skirts of fire. A repose at once milling and aligned, the angel within the maze within the angel. Courage, modesty, laughter, magnanimity, an individuated blue. Your legend, Anne. Eugène Auger, 1857-1927, was a French commercial photographer. His over 10,000 photographs document the historic character of French life. My poem is based on some of his photos of rural French villages to be found in the work of Auger, Volume 1, Old France. On Auger's road, the apple trees turn into light, a liquid light, weightless, spent, so dark, so ruddy brown, they are a sensing that what we do not make is so much more here than what we do. On Auger's road, the souls curve about each other like fish or smoke. Their presence deepens the emptiness of the road itself, or of a cobbled street with no passerby, with stone buildings in which people lived, a past, even more past, in its evoked presence here. But more than street or road, paths trouble his eternity, simple paths, half washed out, wet, leaf litter, the barest trace of human making, a curving into disappearance, slightly rounded, as if earth were felt in such clearing as a pregnancy we could never know, only touch across. Gone is the cry of Auger in Auger, of his roaming now forever past world, in which a stone staircase is so gentle one cups it in one's hand, with the love with which one takes morning water from the faucet in two cupped hands, seeing one's palms through the water, which are thus so remote, not of one, something under water, on Eugène Auger's road, insubstantial as all roads, the vernacular gesture of a road, in which paths and stones flee in place, the enduring velocity of night. National Gallery of Art catalog Wilhelm de Kooning paintings. David Sylvester reports that when in 1977 de Kooning was requested to identify his key influences, he responded, quote, "Oh, I think I would choose Soutine, 1893-1943. I've always been crazy about Soutine, all his paintings. Maybe it's the lushness of the paint. He builds up a surface that looks like a material, like a substance. There's a kind of transfiguration, a certain fleshiness in his work. I remember when I first saw the Soutines in the Barnes collection. The Matisses had a light of their own, but the Soutines had a glow that came from within the painting. It was another kind of light. Over the years, I've written a number of poems and prose pieces on Heim Soutine's art. Soutine's Lapis happens to be 16 pages long, so I will read just the last six pages of it tonight. Around 1925, Soutine tackled a series of gigantic pieces of meat. For the project, he rented a large studio flanked by a collapsing brick chimney on Rue de Saint-Gothard, not far from the Don Rochereau train station. In this workshop, which neighbors came to call Soutine's butcher shop, he began to paint, along with turkeys, cocks, and hanging ducks, enormous quarters of beef. Paulette Jardin, who was at this time Soutine's model and assistant, described the nearly unbreathable atmosphere of the workshop. "I would pose," she said, "and watch the flies that came to tickle Soutine's nose. Then at the Villette slaughterhouse, he bought a whole beef that his dealer, Borowski, paid 3,500 francs for. Soutine was not aware that the beef would rot. I was sent to slaughterhouses to buy blood in a milk pail, blood which sprinkled on the blackening surface refreshed the so-called model. Downstairs, I would always run into some characters questioning me, 'This blood, what is it for?' 'For a sick person,' I would say. 'Oh, well then,' they'd exclaim, 'take care of him.' Soutine would say to me, 'They gave you their most beautiful blood. How lucky I am to have you.' When he was at work, he would throw himself from a distance, bang, 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 at the canvas. I was made to stand behind it, and I was afraid. He bought used canvases, which he carefully scraped. He'd say, 'I like to paint on something smooth. I want my brush to glide.' In that huge studio, I posed while the beef reposed. Big blue flies were circling around. 'These monsters are awful,' Soutine would say, without noticing the putrefying stench to which he appeared to be accustomed. A knock at the door. 'Who's there?' 'Sanitation department.' Panic. A uniformed man walks in to take the beef away. Soutine became deathly pale. 'Oh, please,' he begged. 'Can't you see I'm working? I've got to finish my painting.' Moved to pity, a worker in white came forward and said to Soutine, 'Watch what I'm going to do.' He took out a syringe, a needle, and injected ammonia into the beef. The next day, the sanitation people came to disinfect the studio. Soutine was able to continue. He completed the piece of beef on a blue ground that's in the Grenoble Museum. A day later, Soutine appeared with a bag of syringes. He furiously injected everything. The ducks became rigid as wood, although their feathers lost none of their color. End of the stench. But the carcasses we put out as garbage poisoned the neighborhood dogs. We ended up digging a hole and burying the ammonia-injected meat in quicklime." Soutine's portraits are marvelous machines of consciousness. The coils, the hairpin turns, the ticks, muscle armor, flabby troughs of that weighing station between nothing and an enlarged suckling, each person is the patina of. Crispate fingers that suggest the hand's desire to act the octopus have a beak hidden in palm. Hands knotted in prayer like an inflamed pumpkin, or glove-like and melted. Fingers become nightcrawler independent. Hands as the exhausted straw of the body's peristalsis, as in Woman in Red, broken paired slabs stacked one on one. There's a wildly flopping turkey in each of us, an atavistic flyer manacled to bipedal hesitation. I like the whirling raw hamburger in his faces, the drab fix of their stares. Village idiot and mad woman join Madeleine Castaigne in her black fur and man with straw hat, whose face is toothpaste being as squeezed in pasto, the epididymplosis of the body moiling back on its rind, out of the shtetl forever rocking, a prayer metronome Whitman never knew, repressed missions fade in the choir boy's eyes, the white of his dress almost redeems the color white. It is as stained as an old cooking rag, washed, rewashed, the flecks of parsley, garlic, rancid butter, bits of chopped red pepper. It is a tunic on which fowl has been dried, in which parboiled tomatoes were squeezed into little balls to garnish a chicken in champagne sauce. The page boy at Maxim, blood-drenched red uniform, breaks out in his face and hands, or do his crimson ears and black eyebrow eye pits release their pained, ruined, servile plots into his uniform? Soutine has drawn an empty circle on his outstretched palm. The circle's slightly off. The tip will never be right, never connect with the knee beyond any tip of one ground between tables, whose life is errands. These are faces as charged as marshes with their own uroboric devouring, heads whose source must be in the privation of hewn and crafted images from which Soutine's ancestors suffered. The biblical world sack turned inside out, there tumbles forth, along with flame-shaped praying men and mousy pastry cooks with elephantine ears, Soutine himself. According to Maurice Socks, he was, quote, at first glance, coarse, unplanned, ill-shaped. A thick, haphazardly planted nose, fleshy, pale lips opening on irregular teeth. A single thick eyebrow, stubborn and without malice, barring his forehead crowned with dense black tousled hair. His small, penetrating eyes were of a rare color, a kind of saturnine blue, and their speckled, mazarine gray irises were like fluid, lively, animated agates. He had short hands, but they were admirably shaped, agile, and graceful. 1906, Maurice Tupman writes, two of his older brothers constantly taunted him, saying, a Jew does not paint. They beat him mercilessly. This cruelty became almost a ritual. Soutine would flee his brothers and hide in the woods until hunger drove him home. Amazing, given the Hitlerian shadow, to ponder his bundled, struggling along children on French country roads in 1939. A boy holding the hand of his younger sister. Two boys sprawled on the lawn. Soutine in the woods at 46, still hiding from those who would watch him paint. Quote, one day when Soutine was about 16, he approached a pious Jew and asked him to pose for a portrait. The next day, the man's son and his friends thrashed Soutine viciously and left him for dead. It was a week before he could walk again. A complaint was lodged against the aggressors by Soutine's mother, and the boy was granted his compensation, the sum of 25 rubles. With the money, Soutine and Michel Piquan set off for Minsk to become artists. David Sylvester. In the Serret paintings, the forms are dense and congested, and their nearness makes them loom up, dangerously close, threatening to burst through the picture plane and having to be held at bay. As if fearing an attack from them, Soutine assaults them. The canvas becomes a battleground between the menacing force of whatever confronts the painter and the bending force of the painter's will. And this becomes Soutine's pattern, to put himself in a position from which he feels that something is threatening him, so that he must attack it, wrestle with it, twist it, wring its neck. It is as if he can only make contact with the external world through an act of violence and violation. So the terrible beating that paid off, that brought him to Minsk, that enabled him to become a painter, is endlessly restated, nearly transformed. At some point in the late 1920s, the furnace of combat cools, as if to say Soutine woke up one morning with the battle behind him on the far side of transformation, as if the transformation were the moment of falling asleep, the moment were always before or beyond, never consciously in. A great chaos of magnificent trees sweeps through the last 8 years of Soutine's life, soaring, waving poplars, oaks, beside roads outside of Chartres, Sivry, and Champigny. Trees like giant wisps tremble in awe at Earth's arborescent flavor. For the first and only time in Soutine, one looks up into green dragons devouring blue serpents, a darkening stir, the cauldron not on Earth, but a cathedral tower level, where our eyes give out, where we peek as watchers. The engorged boa roads of Kanya are now delta-shaped inlets, humble rural paths, the tiny children almost lost in ruts and greenery, ladybugs in the tapenade of the ground. The minuteness of the human relative to the vastness of nature recalls the Chinese floating world of sages perched on pine-covered, mist-worn cliffs. Two children move along the road as if bayous, strange twins, or little comrades with two arms gesturing from a single fused body bearing two heads. These kids are Soutine with his natal demon, exulting in the grand and wrestling doorway of nature's slapstick vagina. The tininess of the children, really one child, and the overarching boiling breeze become Soutine's farewell. On a wander route with his infant demon, he is haloing himself back through and into the forestal gradations of the teepee-like entrance exit, all wavering between. In some of these paintings, the road seems to shoot up through the little figures and twirl on up between the trees to become a skyway. In others, the sky is like mucilage between the trees, an opaque negative of a ghost, not empty space, but a sky-like non-sky. Wind as porous disturbance, pointillistically dispersing the coagulated smoke that was life. Concerning the 1608 painting by Caravaggio, who lived from 1571 to 1610, the beheading of St. John the Baptist, I'm especially indebted to Dominique Cortajar, not only for his essay, Caravaggio in Malta, but also for asking the oratory guards in Valletta's co-cathedral in May 2002 to turn off the two alarm systems so that Carol and I, along with our friends James Heller Levinson and Victoria Ganna, could almost touch the 12 by 17 foot beheading with our noses. The beheading. He shook the Counter-Reformation decorum out of these tableaux vivants, eliminating from painting saccharine distortion and ecclesiastic agitprop. If by the human we mean actual lives kicking up dust as they speak toward us, shattering idealistic frames, then Caravaggio, like Vallejo's human poems, produced human paintings. A young whore in red dress dumped on a simple bed, the death of the virgin. The painting refuses the porcelain vagina. There is no Jesus appearance, just Carmelite men convulsed, confused. Whore or virgin, she is laid out, feet bare, arms and hands dangling, carnivorous, red shadow. The canopy bucks, collapses, stung through by sin and atonement. Caravaggio could not completely slit the Christian corset. He tore it, revealed its sweated inner lining. In the destroyed resurrection, it is said that he depicted Christ as an emaciated convict climbing out of a pit. What was this painter's engine? What does his strong room look like? The 1602 John the Baptist in the wilderness with a gorgeous naked Baptist pulling his ram to him, a gesture rich with animal coitus. And the victorious Cupid, a naked fuckboy with wings, offering himself joyously to the viewer, would not have been realized by a heterosexual painter. He painted the Baptist 8 or 9 times, at first using biblical trappings to be able to work with adolescent flesh. The story of someone living on locusts and wild honey, shaman-like with his lamb or ram familiar, a moral loudmouth, perfect grist for a despot's mill, is of little concern. These attributes only register on Malta, site of Caravaggio's second undoing, 1607. He arrived with a capital ban on him for the accidental killing of Ranuccio Tomassoni, who provoked him over a small debt, meaning anyone can sever his head and present it to a judge for a reward anywhere under papal jurisdiction. With the image of the severed head, we open his strong room. There is a 1597 Medusa with a shocked young Caravaggian face, the 1599 Judith and Holofernes, jetting blood as a repulsed but turned on Judith saws through the neck bone. The fact that the model for Judith is a 17-year-old whore transforms the biblical setting into a brothel. There are three Davids with the head of Goliath, the finest of which done in 1909 or 1910 after the painter's face had been slashed outside a Naples tavern. Depicts a pained, even sorrowing David holding out the head of Caravaggio. David withdraws with his other arm his sword from his crotch. Implication: the beheading of Goliath / Caravaggio is David's self-castration, or the Goliath / Caravaggio head is David's phallus. Tomassoni bled to death from a sword-nicked penis. On Malta, he paints the beheading of St. John the Baptist as payment for becoming a knight of obedience. Prison yard door, 17th century Valletta. Knight in brownish black settles through. Just enough rakes of light to see in silence what men robotically visit on each other. The Baptist, lamb trussed on the dirt, neck partially slit. The executioner, gripping a fistful of long Baptist hair, yanks the head toward us as with his right hand he pulls a small knife from his leather belt sheath. His rigid left arm is vertical architecture. In the deltoids, triceps, radial forearm muscles, contoured with amber shadow, ivory light, I sense a sculptural last judgment. It is as if the ivory tower rose from the ground of the Baptist's rape. The executioner's white bloomer folds have been painted so that between his legs a phallic loop dangles, inches over the Baptist's red cloak covered rump. Under this cloak, his lamb pelt, the two forked legs of which jut out as if from the groin. These are vulva evocative. The castrational humiliation of beheading underscored by implicit buggery. Baptist as catamite. Under the blood oozing from the cut neck, Caravaggio has, the one time in his life, signed F. Michelange directly from the blood flow. In what spirit does the painter sign? F equals Fra, brother, and as a man, condemned to duplicate the Baptist fate, and as a martyr to his own cause, which is, in the spirit of Herodian denunciation, to tell the visual truth, to penitentially argue as an artist the glacial contradiction between transcendental hope and squalid reality. After 1608, along with the Goliath Caravaggio head, there are two Salomes with the Baptist head, including the executioner and the old woman witness, who, like a compressed Greek chorus, holds her own head, head, oh head, oh head, don't leave me now, over the malta beheading. The three float as partially bodied heads in inky blackness about the head charge pattern. The heads of Salome and Granny implicitly share the same torso, as if making up a whole. Given Caravaggio's fixation on the Baptist and Goliath with the signature and the painter's ruined face, a Diana Caravaggio is evoked, a Baptist Goliath, two heads sprouting off the same severed neck or off the same severed erection. While there are soft penises in the hood, there are no erections, so erection may be the undepictable thing, in Vallejo's words, Caravaggio's, quote, dreadful thing, end quote, generating the decapitational obsessions. Neck as erection, stem connecting root to bloom, yes, but also the demonic link between damnation popped head and runaway body. This head that cannot really lose itself as long as the neck yokes. 4 months after becoming a knight, Caravaggio is said to have been thrown into the Fort San Angelo Ublet, to have gotten out of this 11-foot-deep hole, and to have sailed to Syracuse. There is no record of his misdeed or crime on Malta, nor how he was able to escape the hole or who arranged a successful flight. Peter Robb conjectures that the painter got caught with one of the pages that his sponsor had imported into unruly Valletta. Quote, sex with a page would have been the ultimate outrage. So they whisked Caravaggio out of there, stripped him of his knighthood. He left the island without permission, leaving him to his own devices. One of his Maltese paintings is a portrait of his sponsor, a Lope de Vignancourt, Grand Master. Next to Vignancourt, in full armor, is a page in red hose, looking directly at the painter, as very few subjects do, holding Vignancourt's large red-plumed helmet. If one takes the Goliath Caravaggio head from David's grasp and superimposes it over the Grand Master's helmet, Rope's conjecture is realized. Grand Master, surely the profoundly offended in this scenario, delectable page, and Caravaggio as the Goliath to be, a kind of menage a trois. The unacknowledged Maltese crime is in its own way duplicated in July 1610. Caravaggio has disappeared. His body is never found. All the official reports of his demise make no sense. Rob thinks he was murdered, probably by people associated with the family of the man he had killed. Martyrdom and salvation are packed into the double Caravaggio head. His paintings show in compressed form a new self released from scholastic rote, cloaked in Venetian red. Behind it, desire for revelation, not of a transcendental ilk, but of the soul made monstrous. Out of this full showing, the true life of humanity, the poor, the tortured, the saintly, the common, mother and child, may assemble. Caravaggio gyrates on in me. I have in my stomach some of his hermetic lantern shards, undigestible martyrdom, salvation.
Can I turn the slide off for a second?
Yes.
I can't look at it. I'm blind.
Well, having breakfast in Hotel Kendall in Cambridge, Massachusetts in 2007, I noticed an elaborate and quite charming toy displayed in the dining room. It was called Parade. Mr. Wheelhead in top hat with feather fiery fuse. He's blind. He leads the parade. Rolling in place, he's followed by Mr. Tenpin Head, paintbrush hair legless on rusted turned sideways wheels. He's got a flag on a tall wire, stiff in no wind. Childhood frozen like a goofy parade, toys as a form of sleep's wheeled yet wooden gestures. With stump arms too short to reach the steering wheel, Mr. Gnome is driving the caged animal truck. Mr. Nearly All Legs is a white striped split pole, glove hand on a long arching stick. Each toy a cartoon of our wandering. Hotel Kendall's lobby, buffet breakfast bound. All of us on wheels that don't belong. All of us shadowed by a tall, gowned, billowing lady thrusting up her parasol. She too is on wheels. Mouth a smeared yawn. Nancy Sparrow, 1926-2009, engaged the life and mind of Antonin Artaud in two major projects, Artaud Paintings and Codex Artaud. I see Nancy's Artaud projects as catalysts for her images of feminine release, taken from many cultures and times, including Greek dildo dancers and Irish Ypsilantis, that proliferate through her art of the 1980s and 1990s. We put some of her Ypsilantis on the cover of Sulfur 28 at the end of the reading if you want to see Sheila. Welcome to. Ode to Nancy Sparrow. Daughters, Nancy Sparrow mined through Artaud, plunging into his bola hula, the seminal muscle of her tongue, to release these painter-crusted rayhops, to let them strip and restrip from pedestal to golden lotus, the binocular manacles from their feet, to let them ungag their cunts, to let their cunts stick out their tongues, to let them dance inside out the accordion akimbo kick, the dildo trot, the serpentine waver prance, Mrs. Gig and her wiggling tricksters rotating through the monument blockage, rooted and free. And I'll end my program with a poem called Across the Bering Strait. Mary Ann Unger, 1945 to 1998, was a powerful sculptor best known for her large-scale works evoking the body bandaging flesh and bone. In Sulfur 40, and I have a copy of Sulfur 40 here so you can see some of her art at the end of the reading if you'd like. In Sulfur 40, we showed several pages of Unger's sculptures along with an article that Carl Harriman wrote on Unger's art. The Bering Strait is located between Russia and the United States. It is thought that Paleo Indians may have migrated from Asia to America some 20,000 years ago, when low ocean levels exposed a wide stretch called Beringia of the seafloor. Across the Bering Strait, long bundles arching over stumps, tongues over crumbling teeth, bundled poles over hunched coals pouring, cinder by cinder forward. I see Marianne Unger in death, still carrying glyptodontal loads, the backwash of her life, her cancer, her mastodontal desire to push on. Siberian hunters at 20,000 BP, moving several miles a year across a 55-mile land bridge, the linked and the loaded, following the great sloth, the short-faced bear, following camels, yaks, tapirs, ringed by the saber and the scimitar-toothed, eyebrowed humanity. Unger sees them as bending tusks sprouting out of mammoth-headed ice, the lurch folk about whom we know nothing, for Beringia is gone. Like a shrub ox or capybara, the land bridge with their footsteps, their middens, the bones of the peccaries they killed. Homage to Marianne Unger, dead in 1998, a sculptor. She grasped these lurching, lugging entanglements across the Bering Strait, the bearing of weight over time, over the land bridge of a life. Wrappings, pilings, backpacks, loaded baby slings, moving toward a mystical organome where all is organ, a paradise of animals, following the crazy quilt meat drift to penetrate the animal realm, to get animal know-how, humankind, like loosely tied poles lurching on over boulder knolls, eating tundra smut, gotta travel, gotta follow the horns. Horn of a moose, horn of an elk, first flag.